someone used this term COVID, and I said, "What COVID? What's that?" You know, COVID, what are you talking about? It's been knocked off the front page here in the Bay Area. We don't even know what that is anymore. It's wildfires, you know. And it's nice to see, you know, it just shows you it's possible, right? There's something worse comes along. It's like you forget all about, you know, what that was. So we're not dialed into COVID at all at this point. Good news is it's getting better here. The firefighters are winning. The weather is cooperating. Yeah. So hopefully we can begin to go beyond that and get our attention on what's super important. And really, we know at this point, November 3rd is the election in the United States. And we also know pretty much that no matter who wins, the other side is not going to accept it. They're going to say it was fixed. It was fixed. They're already positioning themselves, pre-programming everyone to believe that their loss is because the other side cheated and fixed the whole thing, and we're not going to accept this. Both sides are doing that. It's been going back and forth. We know this is going on. And so we may have, by the time like November 9th rolls along, we may have just a complete standstill in the United States in terms of people just, you know, like, wow. We've decided that we're going to not accept, you know, the election has been invalidated. Half the people are not going to accept it. What do we do from there? Well, fortunately, we have advance warning of this, as we always do. And so what we're focusing on is called the answer. I asked for the answer. It's called miracle methoding, the miracle method. And I'm implementing that now. And it's working. It's working. Now, the folks that believe that this simulation of a supposed problem with reality, in order to figure out how to fix reality, supposedly there's supposed to be a problem with reality, we're simulating that problem, which is the universe, and we're using that to try and figure out how to fix reality. Those people say you can't use miracles because that invalidates the laws of nature. You know, the laws of nature, what do you mean? The laws of your simulated fantasy of a problem with reality? That's not nature. It's a fantasy. They say, well, if you violate those laws, then we'll lose sight of what the problem with reality actually is. You'll lose sight of what isn't there. How could you lose sight of what isn't there? You know, it's just absurd. So if those who want to continue to believe that this fantasy of simulating what we believe is a problem with reality so we can learn how to fix it, that's just an absurd whim. If those people want to go along with that, that's fine. They could go along with that if they want to continue. But the rest of us don't have to keep believing that nonsense. So we don't have to follow the laws of a fantasy simulating a non-existent problem. What is that? Absurdist whim. So we can certainly use miracles. Miracles are really super synchronicity. And that is just everything seems to show up at the right place at the right time for you. And so this is, I started this today more intensely. And I wanted to see what happened. And it happened fantastically. Everything did seem to show up at the right time. I was like, gee, I got a really bad problem. And then somebody, I say, hey, where this sand, you know, what is the sand doing here? And they says, oh, I don't need it. Well, I said, that's exactly what I was looking for. And I was supposed to get it somewhere else, but they were out of it. And now you have it here and you need it. No, you can take it. And I say, what? You know, and then everything just showed up. Like boom, 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 like that the whole day. I was like, wow, it works. It works. It works. Of course it works. So there is a way out of this madness in a functional sense, which is a miracle method. So there's a reason why Jesus pre-taught us starting in 1976. 1976. Yeah, was that the 1776, 18, the 200th year anniversary of this, of the country, 200th year anniversary, 1776, 86, 1776. Yeah. Interesting. It taught us the miracle method. Get us ready. Get us into the groove of the miracle method. And we call it here super synchronicity. Everything just shows up at the right moment. everything just clicks, clicks for you, clicks. And what seemed to be impossible, like nature has stopped me. Now suddenly you just go right past it like that. It's no problem at all. So, but how to the key is to this is you have to have consistent miracles. You have to allow miracles to continue. So in the past, what people did is they prayed for a miracle. Praying for a miracle says, I'm sick. I've got this problem. Please, God, give me a miracle. Give me a miracle. Give me a miracle. And maybe they got a miracle. Okay, like that. And they said, oh, there is a God. I got a miracle. Isn't that great? But what we're doing here is the next step. And that is continuous miracling, just shocked by continuous miracling. Wow. Just allowing continuous miracling. Wow. Just accepting continuous miracling. Wow. Just delighting in continuous miracling. Wow. Just loving continuous miracling. Wow. Just abiding in continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. So I started this continuous miracling practice today. In the realization that we have been blocking ourselves by asking for a miracle, singular. Now we're shifting to continuous miracling. It doesn't stop. And that's what we need going forward in this world. We need continuous miracling. Continuous miracling. So I'm training myself, subconscious mind. I'm programming the subconscious mind to accept that, to allow that. And it's like, wow, how come I didn't think of that before? That's wow. It's like a huge paradigm shift today. Huge, huge paradigm shift. Just shift to, yeah, miracle here, miracle here, miracle here, miracle here. Continuous miracling. I thought, like, well, I don't want to ask too much from, God. No, God is inexhaustible. And so God wants us, the great perfection wants us to ask for continuous miracling. That's how we're going to be able to get around this trouble that's coming real fast up on us, coming real fast on us. There was a police car coming up at me today, real fast. The car was at a stoplight, the front of a stoplight. I turned onto a road and I was driving forward. I was looking in the rearview mirror. I said, okay, I was paying attention. And then the light turned green, and so the cars in the stoplight are starting to go. I'm still driving. They're way behind me. I said, okay. I said, let me check where that police car is. I said, I'm doing 40. Okay, that's good. And I couldn't see the police car in my rearview mirror. I said, whoa, it must have turned off. I said, oh, that's weird. I don't know if there are any side streets. What's going on? That's unusual. Then I looked in my right mirror, and there was the police car over in the right lane going real fast. The only problem was the right lane is merging into my lane. And it's a very nasty, quick merge there, because I know I've been through this many times and almost had accidents there because the merge is no warning almost at all. And suddenly your lane ends. And I said, whoa. This could be, he's going to hit me. This is crazy. So I saw that and immediately shifted over to the left lane. And the police car went right past me like that. And then went up and did a U-turn. I said, what is he doing? How interesting. He's coming up on us real fast. So it's something depicting something here that some real trouble is coming up, is going to come up on us like almost unexpected, really, really fast. If you're alert to it, as I was, something told me, check, make sure you know where this police car is. Saw it, knew what to do instantly, sidestepped it like that. It was smooth as can be, smooth as can be, but it could have been a big problem. So we know, and I was working on this miracle, continuous miracling. So we know what to do, how to sidestep this crazy simulation fantasy that we call a universe, which is simulating what we believe is to be a problem with reality, so we can figure out how to fix this problem, when in fact there isn't any problem with reality whatsoever. And I've verified that perfectly by a very extended period of time being aware of reality in a vision and just checking it out. I said, is there something wrong there? Nothing's wrong with it. It's functioning absolutely perfectly, flawlessly. It's just like, oh, I love this, totally love this. So there isn't any need for us to believe that there's any problem with reality. And we certainly don't need to simulate that there's a problem with reality, and then try to function in the simulation, trying to figure out, you know, how to fix this simulation, what's wrong with this, in this simulation. But we're so used to this simulation that we keep feeling that we need it to some extent, you know, the parameters, the continuity parameters of this universe. Okay, fine. That's understandable. Be kind to ourselves. Certainly the grace of God is kindly to us. It's very kind. It's not demanding, you know, some sort of stringency in terms of you must drop this universe, period, or else. It's kindly to us and says, I understand that you're so familiar with this that it's asking too much to just completely drop the universe, this simulation. So you could keep the basic parameters of the simulation, except the workings of nature within the simulation are going to be flexible, are going to become much more flexible, actually. So again, when you feel like, gee, I have a problem, whoops, no, there's the solution just shows up like that. And we say, oh, wow, you know, that's amazing. It's a miracle, we would say. And so what Jesus wanted us to do, wants us to do, is to go from asking for a miracle to asking for continuous miracling. And fortunately, the message finally got through after 42 years here of it just, you know, I couldn't. It's just something about feeling like this, the scarcity of reality, as if reality has a problem. I don't better not ask for too much. Can I just get a miracle, please? Well, you get one. But that's all you ask for, because your expectations are, that's it. So if our expectations are continuous miracling, that's what's going to happen for us. You see, but it's up to our expectations. So that's why we had to leave the old expectations behind, not in a kindly way. We're not unkind to the way we used to believe. It's understandable based on our fear that if we leave this simulation behind without coming up with a fix for the problems of reality, we'll have eternal discontent because reality won't function properly for us. So we're being real careful, say, God, you know, just give me one miracle. I don't want to stress you out too much, you know. Like, I think you're maybe not working too well, God, but you might be able to give me one last miracle, you know. Okay. But now we're realizing there's nothing wrong with God, so there's nothing wrong with asking for continuous miracling. So they kind of go hand in hand to recognize there's nothing wrong with reality whatsoever, never will be, and asking for continuous miracling. Those go together. So we've been working on this, you know, that there's nothing wrong with reality-ing at all. And so now we're able to introduce this, the next step, which is the pragmatic step, the kindly pragmatic step of just continuous miracling. Wow, just shocked by continuous miracling. Wow, just allowing continuous miracling. Wow, just accepting continuous miracling. Wow, just delighting in continuous miracling. Wow, just loving continuous miracling. Wow, just abiding in continuous miracling. Wow, just continuous miracling. Wow, just continuous miracling. Wow. So this is a huge, huge, huge critical step, to say the least. It is the crucial paradigm shift that we have been working towards. And it just happened today. It just happened today where it's just full blast. It's full blast now. It was very difficult to do. I made a video trying to do it. Maybe I'll put that up for you. I don't know. But I was struggling bad. I reached a point where I was just like gridlocked in my mind. My resistance and my willingness were like battling back. I could hardly breathe. I was like, just this huge nails on a chalkboard feeling. I was like, And I couldn't seem to go through the seven steps. I kept getting stumbling all over the place and stopping. And I said, what's going on? So this represents, you know, that this paradigm shift, there's residual resistance from familiarity. But understanding this and having gone through it in lots of different ways, I just soldiered on. I said, no, I'll get this. It'll smooth out. I'll just keep working at it. But it was difficult. But I spent the whole day just working on it. And so now I just shocked by continuous miracling. Wow. Just allowing continuous miracling. Wow. Just accepting continuous miracling. Wow. Just delighting in continuous miracling. Wow. Just loving continuous miracling. Wow. Just abiding in continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. But this is a result of an entire day of intense struggle with this. You'd think it's easy, but because it's such a fundamental paradigm shift, it turned out to be very difficult, and I was very tired. I had to take a nap of like 2 hours or so more. I could hardly move. So tired. Did some hard work too during the day, and actually people showed up to save me. I was saying, oh, this is going to kill me. The work is so hard. Holy cow. And suddenly somebody shows up and basically does it for me, you know, stuff like that. It is happening. This happens all the time, except it's happening more as I allow it to happen more and more and more. It's happening more and more and more. And now I realize we can allow this on a grand scale, actually. And it's necessary on a grand scale, because the demand that we double down in our worshiping of false hope, that demand is going to be super strong coming up, super strong, as if it isn't already. It's going to be way stronger than it is now. Mid-November, November, I'd say give it a week after the election, November 9th, let's say, is really a great target date, November 9th. So we really have to be into this new paradigm big time. By then, big time. And so what is today? I don't know. It's what does it say here? Okay, so the 25th of August is when we shifted into this new paradigm, because we had intent. We knew we had to do this something. And so this practice came up to me this morning, and I stumbled and just had the most difficulty. I said, wow, this must really be on to something, because there's so much resistance to this. I said, what's the resistance? Why? But there is. There's so much resistance. If we feel that reality is decrepit and, you know, and barely functioning or in a coma or something, we're like, we're afraid to ask too much of it. You know, gosh, if I ask too much, this might, you know, put an end to reality. Better be careful. You know, don't ask even for one miracle. You know, it's too much. This is the zeitgeist of the time. It's like, don't even ask for one miracle. I mean, it's on, reality's on life support, you know. What are you doing? You're going to kill reality if you ask for a miracle. And so just to get past all the silliness, you know, this absolute whimsical absurdity, an arrogant, false premise, you know, choosing a false premise instead of just acknowledging that the idea of trying to reverse the direction of creation just doesn't happen. It can't happen. So the feeling is futility. Instead of accepting that, we said, no, the reality is almost dead. That's why it's not giving me the experience of being prime creator, you know. That's just absurd, you know, whimsical arrogance on our part, a mistake on our part. So if we just recognize this mistake and forgive ourselves, we realize there's nothing wrong with reality. Not a thing at all. We just are defending a false premise by simulating what we believe is what's wrong with reality in a fantasy dream, so that we can then try to go to work on the simulation. It gives us the parameters we need to try to come up with a cure for reality, you know. Until there is a cure, no miracles until there is a cure, is the motto of the world at this point. Until there is a cure, yeah, no, don't ask for miracles, because it's exhausting, God. It's exhausting for God. Reality may expire. You keep asking for something from it, and it's just on life support, you know. Careful, don't say anything until there's a cure. Don't ask for anything. It's like, right. And you know, we laugh because it's true. That's really what's going on, isn't it? Except the people now are just like, you know, just drastically, you know, don't stress reality out, you know, at all. It's so fragile at this point. We're onto it, though. You know, we got the robots working on it. You know, they're fixated on what the problem really is, and they're bound to come up with the other. They've got the supercomputers just churning away, yeah, all over the world. And we're certain to find a cure for reality real soon. But meanwhile, don't ask for anything. You know, that's exactly the attitude of the world right now, isn't it? Exactly what the attitude is. And here we know that's complete absurdist fantasy. arrogant false premise fantasy, you know, with only a fool would go along with that. Only a fool or someone who wants to just play the fool, be foolish, and indulge this false premise whim goes along with that nonsense. And if they want to be self-indulgent in that way, that they're going to have to pay the price for that, which is fear, you know? Yeah. But in the meantime, we're not going to keep going along with this idiocy, you know, this simulation of a false premise idiocy and absurdity. Say that, oh, we can't ask any help from God. You know, really? That's utter nonsense. So, dangerous nonsense, causing us tremendous suffering and delay unnecessarily. So nobody has the authority to tell us that we have to imagine such nonsense. Continue, even especially when we know it's totally false and have that's settled science. Actually, there's so many who have found out that it's completely false. It's settled science. There's nothing wrong with reality. Totally settled science. And if there's a bunch of people in the world who want to ignore that, that's on them. That's not on us. That's their problem. Their problem is not our problem. So we can ask for just continuous miracling, wow. Just shocked by continuous miracling, wow. Just allowing continuous miracling, wow. Just accepting continuous miracling, wow. Just delighting in continuous miracling, wow. Just loving continuous miracling, wow. Just abiding in continuous miracling, wow. Just continuous miracling, wow. Just continuous miracling, wow. That's what we say here. And while we're doing that, we're making sure that we're hydrating because we're on the super psychological hydration tour at this point, introducing what? The new paradigm. Better than the Beatles, you know, the Beatles, everybody, conspiracy theory started with the Beatles and the Beatle generation, let's be honest. So many people were convinced that the Beatles were like giving cryptic advice to the younger generation, to the generation, if you love the Beatles, they were communicating with you in code. Every little last thing they did was actually a communication. It started with the Beatles, and the people were really, Beatle generation was so much into that. I mean, what's the height of the Beatles? Well, 1967 was the height of the Beatles. June 1st, I guess, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band was released, and then later, late August or September 1st, something around that, Magical Mystery Tour was released. And then All You Need Is Love was broadcast, satellite broadcast around the world as the final part of this satellite, global satellite broadcast. And that was the song for the Summer of Love in 1967. And, you know, everything the Beatles did was a message. And there are some people who, they said, I'm figuring it out for you. Oh man, the fan magazines. So the youth generation were believes the Beatles were leading us in the right direction to a new world, you know, to a utopia, and they had the vision of it, and they were the ones that were doing it through music and everything, their lives. And the older generation couldn't understand it, but we could understand it, what they were saying, that kind of thing. And that's, you know, and the Beatles are like, you know, what in the world is, you know, what are they talking about? As the people playing all records backwards and insisting that the Beatles were hiding all this coding, you know, when you played the records backwards, they would give you the real message that they were getting through. And, you know, there's all this magic in all the Beatles things of esoteric magic everywhere. And they projected everything onto the Beatles. So just like, crazy. It was so crazy, I tell you. It's just like, and that's still going on. It's still going on. Still going on. So people are just seeing, you know, conspiracies under every rock. This and this and this and this and this and this, and it gets. And so when a real trouble comes up, you know, people are so distracted. It's like, just another this and that. But we already know ahead of time that the two sides, the two political parties in the United States, are already hurling accusations. The other side is attempting drastic measures to steal the election, rig the election and steal it. That's out in the open by the leaders of both parties. They're saying, hey, we're sure of it. We've got, you know, evidence. You're doing this, no question about it. They're just trying to set up in advance to say, I told you so. See, I told you so. Just so they can contest the election and try to maybe have the Supreme Court decide it. you see, are something else. There's no doubt about that. And the two sides are so polarized right now that it's ripe for this scenario. It's ripe for this scenario. So this is not a conspiracy. This is something that's out in the open, jockeying for leverage. Say, you know, if you win, we already know it's completely illegitimate, totally illegitimate. So what do we do then? You see, that's a question, isn't it? But what we do is continuous miracling. So we already know what we're going to do at that point. We're going to do continuous miracling. Wow. And who knows how beneficial that can be. You see, we've been going on a false paradigm that there's something wrong with reality and reality is on life support, so it can only help us a little bit, you see. That's a totally false paradigm, 100% false. So we've been limiting our requests of reality, help us out. Okay, can you just give me a little feel of what I'm supposed to be? Like that, right? Just a little feel. Can you just give me a little feel? Because I don't want to tire you out, God. And that's false paradigm. And now we've shifted the paradigm. We realize there's nothing wrong with reality. Reality is completely robust. Absolutely robust. So we can ask for a little more. Can you just give me a little more of what I'm supposed to be? Seems like some kind of game that I used to play with me. Some kind of game we used to play. And we don't have to play that stupid game anymore of like, wow, maybe I can get, if I get one miracle in my life, that's an amazing life, you know. This is how I used to feel, just, gosh, you know, I'm just get one miracle from God. It's like, I'm going to say, God's still alive, you know, still on life support, but still functioning just a tiny bit. You know, wow, okay, that's good. It's such a huge paradigm shift because that's how it used to be. But now we say, wow, God, reality is like absolutely robust, infinitely, ingingly robusting, wow. And so we could start asking for more. More soup. Yeah. Wow. So we don't know. You know, it's like there's really no boundaries to what we can ask for, actually. But we'll go, you know, we'll kind of gradually ease into that more robust requesting from reality. And wow. Just shocked by continuous miracling. Wow. Just allowing continuous miracling. Wow. Just accepting continuous miracling. Wow. Just delighting in continuous miracling. Wow. Just loving continuous miracling. Wow. Just abiding in continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. So you see, we're going from a feeling of like there's boundaries and just shocked by continuous miracling through seven reactions, so to speak. Then we end up at just continuous miracling. Wow, that's all there is continuous miracling. So first shock, okay, I'm just allowing this. Now I'm accepting it. Now I'm delighting in it. Now I'm loving it. Now I'm abiding in it. That's all there is. So this helps us ease past our boundary fear. This fear is like, whoa, you know, reality's totally robust. I don't have to stop at one miracle in my life. I can have continuous miracling every single moment, actually. Continuous miracling every single moment. That's what we can aim for. Absolutely we can. And we'll ease into that. So getting this paradigm shift is the key to it. And this is what we're doing here. This is what we have been able to do. We're now doing this. Just shocked by continuous miracling, wow. Just allowing continuous miracling, wow. Just accepting continuous miracling, wow. Just delighting in continuous miracling, wow. Just loving continuous miracling, wow. Just abiding in continuous miracling, wow. Just continuous miracling, wow. So it's a great day around the bay, and these wildfires kind of put a little pressure on me here to say, wow, you know, it's like, holy cow, it's like Armageddon is here, the end of the world is here, you know, what do we do? I got a better shift to continuous miracling right now. One's not enough for what we're been going through. Day 8 of the wildfires, you know, and the smoke, and just feeling like, you know, that California's just disappeared, you know, basically. What happened to California, you know? I don't know, it's gone. So then you really got to find an extra gear. And I say, God, you know, I need like a little more miracles. Can we have just a little more miracles here? And then this answer in the form of a practice. Why don't you practice saying just continuous miracling? Wow, just continuous miracling. Wow. And I said, can I say that? And the inner prompting said, of course, yeah, I want you to do that. I want you to do that. And I say, oh, okay, shouldn't be any problem. Let me try this. Whoops, big resistance. I said, oh. Big resistance, huh? Okay, let's keep trying this. Bigger resistance. You know, it's like, wow, somebody wants a struggle here. Okay, let's see how it turns out. And kept doing it. And it was a big, 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 big struggle. Wow. Yeah, but I realized, hey, we got nowhere else to go. You can't go back. I mean, California's disappeared, so to speak. So we can't rely on California anymore, actually. I asked somebody, you know, okay, so you know, it's getting a little better. The firefighters got control of it. The fire lines are holding, and they avoided like the absolute catastrophe. Great, thank you. And so we don't have to worry about that. I said, okay, what's next? And my friend said, earthquake. And I said, yeah, don't say that, but yeah. Now, of course, what else is next? It's got to be an earthquake in California. I don't have any, I'm not privy to any information about that. But we're kind of, you know, gallows humor right there saying, you know, what's next? You know, it's bound to be something terrible. Yeah, absolutely it is, you know, to the Hayward Fault, boom, you know. I say, okay, oh, here's it now, okay. Forget about wildfires. Now we're in earthquakes. It's the not so golden state, right? You know, the last 4 years, actually, it's been the not so golden state. Best thing is that all the techies that are at home, there's nobody on the road. I love that. That's so, you get to like a road where you got to turn onto a road, and you know, usually like there's just cars everywhere. You're like, oh, God. You look and there's no cars anywhere. And it's like, huh? Can I turn? You know, can I go on the road? There's nobody here. What happened? The rapture happened or something? The tech rapture, maybe. You know, it's just like the tech rapture happened. I said, yeah, I could live with that. So it's golden in that way, but not in too many other ways. So you can just zip around now with just so little traffic. All the techies are at home getting DoorDash. And I guess Uber is still functioning here, you know. I guess they were sweating that one. Whoops, no more DoorDash, no more Uber, and everybody's decided I'm not going to work anymore. And how can I get food? I don't want to leave my house, my bunker. Yeah. Wow. Anyway, so the answer was, hey, start just saying, just continuous miracling, wow. Just continuous miracling, wow. Just continuous miracling, wow. Just continuous miracling, wow. I said, that's, yeah, it should be easy. Not so easy. Struggle. So don't be surprised if it's a struggle, but just to say, oh, interesting. A struggle, huh? Okay. Let's see who comes out ahead in this struggle. See? I was interested. I say, okay, let's see. Let's see who comes out ahead. Am I going to be defeated in this struggle, or am I going to come out ahead in this struggle? How's that going to turn out? And I said, okay, let me just keep working on it and see what happens. That's all. I didn't know how tough the resistance would be. You know, I just said, I'll give it my best shot. Just keep working at it and see if the resistance eases up a little bit. And it's easing up a little bit. Yeah, now I realize this is a major, major crucial paradigm shift right here. And it's coming to you live from the Bay Area. Absolutely. The late, great Bay Area. Yeah, it was like 4 years of wildfires, you know, the 5 years of drought and 4 years of wildfire. That is like, we're kind of like, oh, wow, this isn't what I signed up for. Yeah. we're moving past it right now. Just continuous miracling. Wow. Just continue. So thank you, California, for giving us a kick in the seat of the pants saying, hey, get going on continuous miracling. I'm going to make things nasty for you so you could get motivated to do that. Did a great, is doing a great job of that, I'll tell you. So yeah, just continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. 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 Feel free to always use that wow as much as you like. It's super helpful, very calming. It just seems to take the edge off of everything, yeah. Yeah. So all we need is continuous miracling. All you need is continuous miracling, dun 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 dun. All you need is continuous miracling, dun 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 dun. All you need is continuous miracling, yeah. Continuous miracling is all you need, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, all we need is continuous miracling. Not she loves you, yeah. She loves you, yeah. She loves, and with a love like that, you know, you can't be, you should be glad, you can't be sad. How's it go? You should be glad, yeah. Now, you see, you're thinking like, oh, I can only ask for one miracle in this life, and the rest of the time I gotta have love. Now I say, hey, wait a minute, I can have more than one miracle? What do I need all this special love for? What is that stuff, you know? I could have continuous miracle. I don't need love. Wow. Yeah. You see how we got led down this road of thinking like, you know, don't bother God. I said, well, how can I be happy? Love, man, you know. Love the one you're with. Just love the love generation. Everybody just get together and love one another, you know. And it's like, because they're saying like, yeah, don't bother God. God's really sick. It's on life support. You don't want to bother him. So just see if you can get by, you know, with, you know, with physical love, you know, just loving one another. Maybe that'll be enough, you know, that kind of thing. And now we realize, hey, God's not on life support. In fact, God has never been sick. In fact, God doesn't have never had the slightest problem whatsoever. God is absolutely inging, you know, all is inging, wow. All inging, wow. So guess what? We get to ask God for continuous miracling, which brings us back into the acceptance of this complete robustness of reality, this just inging wowness. And that's what we really love. We don't love these corpses, you know, that we're dragging around. What are you supposed to do? Love corpses? All you need to do is love a corpse today, you know. These bodies are corpses, you know. I mean, what are we supposed to, that's supposed to make us happy? Like, I love this person. I love this body. I love the simulation of problems with reality, you know. This is an attractive form of the simulations of the problems of reality. And that's going to make, I got to settle for that. No, we don't. We love reality-ing, just inging wow. We love the just inging wow. Of all, just all inging wow, just all inging wow, just all inging wow, dun 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 dun, just all inging wow, dun 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 dun, just all inging wow, yeah, just all inging wow. So we love just all inging wow. It's intrinsically lovable. That's what we love. We don't love hanging out with corpses. Hey, look, can my corpse hang out with your corpse? Sure, we can love one another. Let's just love. Let's love that. You know, yeah. I said, like, no, because that's not lovable. Corpses aren't lovable. The simulation of the problems of reality, that's not lovable, because that's a lie. Lies aren't lovable. Saying that reality is on life support, that's not something we love. It's something we hate. We say, I hate that reality's on life support. It's horrible. Yeah. But we got to fix it. So how can we hang in there? Well, you got this, love one another. That'll do the job. You know, you'll be able to hang in there until you figure out a way to fix it. No, except miracles, continuous miracling, and the veil will thin out. And so you'll be able to become more and more aware of the all just inging wow, all just inging wow. And then you'll say, I love this. This is totally lovable. Totally lovable. I totally love this. Unreserved, total love. You love all of it equally. All of it equally. All of it equally. That's reality. When you feel you love all of it equally, that's reality. It's not like I found some special part here, the special corpse here that's going to make me happy, you know. At least it's not good. It's going to keep me from like imploding, you know. I can keep working on trying to fix this terrible problem with reality. We're going to be saying that just loving all of it, totally, total love for all of it. Wow. Intrinsic love, intrinsic love. You don't have to work at it. You don't have to say, well, what can I do to keep the love alive, you know. No. This is not even a question of that. It's we intrinsically love the just all-inging wow of reality-ing. All of us do. All of us do. That's the fact. So we get to that by continuous miracling wow. Just continuous miracling wow. So, you know, this is a paradigm shift. So we're trendsetters here, which is not easy to be trendsetters. We understand that because we're just absolutely flipping the script on the past, you know, entirely at this point. And all the different approaches and everybody, we're now putting it in a totally different paradigm, totally, you know, the context, like a new context. And it's a super streamlined, fantastically clear context. And we realize, oh yeah, that's exactly what's going on, actually. And in the past, we were afraid to do this because we said we don't want to stress God, you know, too much. So we'll intimate a little bit about God, you know, maybe this and that, but you be careful. God's very fragile, you know. God might implode, like God imploded when we had asked about, we wanted to experience the idea of reversing the direction of creation and being prime creator, and it was like too much for God, and God had a stroke, you know. Had a stroke. Holy cow. So be careful. Don't say too much, you know. Tiptoe around it. God's fragile. And so we've had this spiritual fragility for so long, and everybody's tiptoeing around it. So I came into the world, and it's like, okay, I got this very clear picture. You know, I know what's going on. And everybody says, no, you can't say that. God's fragile. You're going to kill God if you say that. You're going to stress. You want God to get another stroke? Huh? You're like that. I said, what are you talking about? And there's like, they said, you're horrible. Shut up. You know, you can't say that. Shh. God's sleeping. He's real fragile. You might wake God up and God will hear you say it. You want a whole bunch of miracles and God will try and then God will have another stroke and die. So shut up. And I was like, what did I just wander into an insane asylum, you know? Yeah. It hasn't been fun. But now the cat's out of the bag. The cat's out of the bag, finally. And we can talk openly about this true, clear context of what's really taking place here. And the obvious now, we can ask for just continuous miracling. Wow. But it's been an extremely difficult struggle because, I mean, we understand why people thinking that God's on life support say, look, if you want to talk about God, shh, you know, be real quiet. Don't wake God up, you know, just kind of, you know, don't ask too much. Don't. And my God might say, oh, I need to start functioning again. Somebody wants me to function like God. But it might be, it's too much for God. It's too much for him. Yeah. Very fragile. So we've had to really, 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 really skate on thin ice, you know, and just kind of circumlocution. Don't talk about it too clearly or carefully or stuff. So it's all been very vague and foggy. You know, spirituality has been so vague and foggy and nebulous. And I say, what's wrong with you guys? Why don't you just tell the truth here? So, no. God's fragile. Can't handle the truth. Okay, so now we see it's utter nonsense. Total nonsense. Just whimsical false premising. Wow. Just whimsical false premising. Wow. Ego tripping, you know, to the max. Choosing a false premise, then you're often ego tripping, saying, oh boy, reality really has a problem. Instead of admitting we can't be prime creator, that's ego tripping. So, but it's been incredibly difficult here because of the fear of everybody that you're going to mess everything up. You say, we're, you know, God's on life support, but we almost got the right medicines, you know. These computers, they're going to figure it out. Just wait a little longer. And we're coming up with the medicine. We're coming up with it. Yeah. And this research on the COVID is really going to help us too. See, that's why we got COVID. It's going to help us develop these really amazing, you know, medicines and vaccines. And then we can give God that vaccine and strengthen God, you know, gradually, baby, gradually. don't press. So this is just absolute insane asylum madness, a false premise insanity, you might say. False premise absurdity to be kinder. False premise absurdity. We don't need to come up with any medicine for God or a vaccine for God or to strengthen God. God doesn't need to be strengthened. God is absolutely robust. Completely robust. Eternally robust. All just inging wow is reality and experiencing that directly realize all is just inging completely. Total robustness. Not a trace of weakness whatsoever in reality-ing. And then, you know, the cat's out of the bag when you have a vision of reality like that. That was February 26, 2020. So it's been, seven months or something like that. Yeah. February. It's 26 February, maybe 6 months. March, April, May, June, July. 6 months. Yeah, right. 6 months. It's been 6 months. So from Coach Neelam's seven-step practice was February 1st. 26th of February was a vision of reality. So it was about a month there, a little less than a month. And then from that date till now, when the paradigm shift happened, was 6 months. So it took me 6 months from the vision of reality-ing to this paradigm shift. 6 months of very, very, very intense focus and practicing. And, you know, it's like I thought, am I going to get there? And this is like I should be there by now. You know, wow, this is difficult. What's the problem? And now we see what the problem is in hindsight. Wow. Yeah. Don't stress God. You know, we got the people up there who'll tell you a little bit. They'll help you not stress God out. We'll train you how not to stress God. You know, sure, you can believe in God, but you don't want you to stress you out. Don't stress. We don't want to stress God out. So this is how you got to look at it. You got to look at it this way. And sure, you might be able to get a miracle, but first you got to kind of go through different channels and they'll check with God. The nurse will check with God to ask God, how are you feeling today? You know, should you give a miracle to so-and-so? And then the nurse comes back and says, God's not feeling so well today. You know, you're not going to be able to get a miracle today, but maybe later on, God might be feeling a little bit better. You know, so we have, you know, we have this nurse staff, you know, nurses of God that we're supposed to ask them first, you know, all these channels we have to go through. Yeah. That's odd. Odd flight path. So we're trained, and all these channels you have to go through. You have to ask this person, and this person will ask somebody else, and this whole chain, like God's in intensive care, and there's a head nurse of intensive care, and she knows, you know, that she's the only one that can talk to God. And then there's another staff that goes and tells her requests, and then there's staff, other messengers who tell the staff, you know, to get to her that you go to, you know, check. And then there's other people, intermediaries. So when you ask for a miracle, say, can I have a miracle? Yeah, I really please. Okay, we'll run that through the, you know, the system. We'll run it up to headquarters here, and we'll maybe, you know, sometimes we work. So, and yeah, and then, but usually it's like, well, you know, it's a little iffy. The situation's a little iffy right now. You know, we don't want to strain God too much, but maybe in a little while, might be able to give you a miracle. We'll find, you know, maybe. But if we all praise it, God, you know, please get better, God. You know, please get better, God. I really hope you feel better. You know, and so you'll be able to give me a miracle, that kind of thing. That's where we've been. We're not there anymore. We're not there anymore at all. utter silliness, okay, but logical based on a false premise. You see, when we choose this false premise that there's something wrong with reality, then the logic, chain of logic follows from this. But it's all absurdity. It's completely silly because it's completely false. God's not in ICU. There's no ICU in reality, ing. All is inging, wow. Okay? All is inging, wow. That's reality ing. There's not some person dishing out, you know, I can give you a little this or a little that. All is inging, wow. It's all inging. There's just this eternal that in an endless inging. Everything is alive. It's all inging. That's reality ing. Totally robust. Endlessly robust. Eternally robust. So, you know, we don't need to go through that whole rigmarole, you know, anymore. And this whole thing about the nurse going in the ICU and checking on God, that's just an absurdist fantasy on our part. Totally absurdist fantasy. But we've been trained so intensely to do that. And then there are those who've been trained to say, don't even ask. It's God's, you know, those last legs, you know, don't even ask. It's so fragile. Don't even think about it. And then people say, okay. I'm not even going to believe in God because if I do, I might ask for something, you know, and that'll bring an end to God, to reality. It'll bring an end to it. So I'm not even going to believe there's a God at all. You know, that kind of thing. Well, there's no God in ICU. I'll tell you that. But there is just inging wow. All inging wow. Reality-ing, wow. There is reality-ing, wow. There is reality-ing, wow. And that is absolutely fluid, totally fluid. So that, we could ask that for continuous miracling, wow. That's, you know, it is continuous. That's what it is. It is continuous fluidity-ing and inging. That's what realitying is. So continuous miracling is just would be a natural functioning for it. You see, just it's functioning, yeah. Just saying, hey, reality, I'll accept the fact that you're functioning naturally the way, you know, perfectly. And indeed, then we start getting that intimation that this is indeed true. And there is no ICU for, yeah. Wonderful here. So yeah, it's just like the air cleared enough here so we could actually start focusing a little bit here, getting a little bit of pep in our step. Okay, what's the next big thing? So before it hits, you know, before the earthquake hits, let's make sure we get this paradigm out there. Spread it throughout the world, all over the world. Everybody in the world's gonna feel tonight. Let's everybody feel this tonight, the paradigm shift. The paradigm shift here. The paradigm shift. Wow. Just continuous miracling. 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 Wow. I hope this uploads. I finally got one longer video to upload. This has to upload. You know, upload. I don't know if it will or not, but just continuous miracling, let it upload. We're ready for it to upload. We're ready to move on this because we know we have to. We have to. We can't be playing these silly games anymore with these absurdists, you know, false premise absurdists. False premise absurdists are just false premise absurdists. That's all. They've got this, you know, their conclusions are insane because their premise is false. Their conclusion that God's in ICU is false because their premise is false. You cannot arrive at true conclusions through a false premise. Okay, we cannot arrive at true conclusions through a false premise. It's not possible. Not possible at all. So there is no God in ICU. Well, there is no God in ICU. There is no God in ICU. Can't come from truth from a false premise. Can't have a false premise arrive at truth. Can't have a false premise arrive at truth. So sure, they have conclusions. They're false conclusions. coming from a false premise. We're not saying they don't have conclusions. They have lots of conclusions. They're concluding that God's on life support in ICU, and you need to go through all this really complicated chain up to the head nurse who's going to check and see if God's capable of doing anything at all. And then she's going to say, nah, you know, we got to err on the side of caution here, you know. We'd love to give you a miracle today, but, you know, it's just too risky. It's too risky. Better don't risk it, so don't ask again. You know, it's just kind of bothering me. It makes me nervous. Don't want to even tempt fate here, folks. You know, like that. Don't tempt fate. Let's just keep working on trying to come up with the right medicines for God. You know, let's keep working. Science is on it. You know, they're really on it. You know, yeah. We're really delving into the heart of it now. You know, we're figuring it out. You know, got the whole, yeah. That's just all. You know. False conclusion, false conclusion, false conclusion from a false premise. And that as long as we have a false premise, the false conclusions just continue, 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 ad absurdum. So I say, give us a continuous miracle, a discontinuous miracle, and get this video up. Get this paradigm shift underway. Yeah. And just you know, we don't know just the fluidity that we're going to have when we start getting continuous miracling. But it will just start feeling like, hey, I'm starting to feel like myself again. This is interesting. Yeah. And it just say, I love this. And it feels like I can learn to, you know, if it keeps going this direction, I'm going to love this, you know. We're not going to say we love it yet, because that's not true. It's not our full fluidity-ing, but we're starting to feel the little bit of breeze, like, hey, yeah, I love this fluidity I've got going here like that. Wow. And it gets better and better and better and better. So we've probably all had moments where we seem to recover that fluidity, you know, just risk it just a little bit. You know, say, like, oh, but that didn't hurt God, you know. And they say, yeah, I like that. I like that direction. That's going to happen more and more and more and more and more and more and more. Just I feel so fluid in all directions of creativity, expression. Just I don't feel stuck. I don't feel stuck anywhere. Wow. I feel it's okay to have continuous miracling that helps my fluidity emerge more and more and more. This inginess just emerge more and more and more. I was dancer-sizing yesterday, and I was very fluid. You know, it's like, wow. I said, holy cow, look how fluid I am, more than ever. Haven't done it for quite some time. And it's just the fluidity was just every direction. I could just feel like creative in all directions, you know. I was like, yeah, okay, that's a nice trend. That's a really nice trend. It's trending in the right direction. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. Just shocked by continuous miracling. Wow. Just allowing continuous miracling. Wow. Just accepting continuous miracling. Wow. Just delighting in continuous miracling. Wow. Just loving continuous miracling. Wow. Just abiding in continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. Just continuous miracling. Wow. And yeah. Yeah. We got the miracles. Yeah. We got continuous miracling. Yeah. With a fluidity like that, you know you should be glad. Yeah. Continuous miracling. Yeah. It's the summer of continuous miracling. Wow. Summer of continuous miracling. Wow. It is. It's the summer of paradigm shift. Wow. The summer of continuous miracling. Wow. There you go. Summer of continuous miracling. Wow. Summer of continuous miracling. Wow. Summer of continuous miracling. Wow. We're going big. We're going real big. We're going real big. Real big. Real big. Paradigm shift. Fundamental paradigm shift here. It's bigger than big. It's a fundamental paradigm shift that has now occurred. And I'm going to bring this in under 1 hour in case there's some kind of weird cutoff at an hour, 1 hour or something. I gotta get this out and get the paradigm shift going so it's flowing. Get the paradigm shift going so it's flowing all over the world. Everybody in the world's gonna feel tonight. Woo, 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 woo. Yeah, like that. Wow.